Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, I would like to invite Yang Berbahagia Dr. Zakir Naik to come forward to the stage. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته dan salam sejahtera. Yang Berbahagia Pendakwah Ulung Dr. Zakir Naik, Yang Amat Berhormat Datuk Seri Haji Ahmad Razif bin Abdul Rahman Menteri Besar Terengganu, dan Yang Amat Berbahagia Tuan Seri Haji Halina binti Zakaria, Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri Haji Idris bin Yusof, Ahli Parlimen Besut merangkap Menteri Pendidikan Tinggi, dan Yang Berbahagia Tuh Puan Cik Kamaria binti Zakaria, Yang Berhormat Datuk Haji Wan Nawawi bin Haji Wan Ismail, dan Tuh Puan, Yang Berhormat Esku-Esku Kerajaan Negeri, Yang Berbahagia Tuan Haji Samion bin Saleh, Timbalan Setiausaha Kerajaan Pengurusan, Yang Berbahagia Datuk Abdul Rahim Yusof, Pegawai Daerah Besut, dan Tuan Puan, Datuk-Datuk, Datin-Datin, Tuan-Tuan, Puan-Puan yang diraikan pada malam ini, sekali lagi Assalamualaikum Warahmatullahi Wabarakatuh. Before we get started, I would like to invite all of you to recite Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar 3 times. Together with me. Tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, saya mengajak tuan-tuan untuk sama-sama kita menyebut Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar sebanyak 3 kali bersama-sama dengan saya. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We managed to be here together tonight with the most prominent speaker, the international scholars, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Zakir Naik. I believe that it is not that easy to bring Dr. Zakir Naik here tonight. And I come to know that the man behind the scene to ensure that this program becomes a reality is our beloved Menteri Besar Terengganu. Terima kasih Yang Amat Berhormat Datuk Seri, dan terima kasih kepada Kerajaan Negeri Terengganu. The venue today, tonight, is at School of Imtiaz, which was inspired by our former Menteri Besar Terengganu Datuk Seri Idris Yusof. And Dr. Zakir Naik, one of the uniqueness of Terengganu is the establishment of the School of Imtiaz. It integrates the aqli and naqli proposition in the teaching and learning activities. So that's the beauty part of Terengganu. Congratulations to School of Imtiaz. Ladies and gentlemen, for the benefit of all, I would like to inform that this lecture session will be divided into 2 parts. In the first part, Dr. Zakir Naik is going to deliver his speech entitled Does God Exist? In English. In the second part, the most awaiting part, is the question and answer session, and inshallah, I will provide the rules of the session later. Before I hand over this session to Dr. Zakir Naik, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce briefly Dr. Zakir Naik. Dr. Zakir Naik is a medical officer by profession, if I'm mistaken. He has been recognized as the top 500 most influential Muslim scholars in the world. And without further ado, I would like to call upon Yang Berbahagia Dr. Zakir Naik to deliver his speech entitled Does God Exist? Please welcome.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Sanurihim ayatina fil afaqi wa fi anfusihim hatta yatabayyana lahum annahu al-haq. Awalam yakhfi bi rabbika annahu ala kulli shay'in shahid. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri وَهَلُّ الْعُقْدَةُ مِنْ لِسَانِ يَفْكَوْ كَوْلِي. The Honourable Chief Minister of Telangana State, the Honourable Education Minister of Malaysia, my respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greeting, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of Almighty God be on all of you. It's an honor and a pleasure for me to be invited by both the ministers to the state of Telangana as well as this Imtiaz School of Excellence. This is my sixth visit to Malaysia, but so far I think is going to be my best visit, inshallah. The topic of this evening's talk is, does God exist? This talk of mine, does God exist, is for three categories of people. Number one, those people who do not believe in the existence of God. Category one, they are the atheist. Category two are those people who are not sure whether God exists, are silent as far as God exists, and they are called as agnostics. And the third category of people are those people who do believe that God exists, but they cannot prove to the others the existence of Almighty God. And I believe that Telangana has more than 95% Muslims, alhamdulillah. So I believe the third category of people will be majority in the audience. And this lecture is also very important for the third category of people, those who do believe in existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, but they cannot prove the same to the others. Whenever I meet an atheist who does not believe in the existence of God, the first thing I do is I congratulate him. You may be wondering, Why is Dr. Zakir congratulating an atheist? The reason I'm congratulating him is because most of the human beings, they are doing blind belief. He's a Christian because father is a Christian. He's a Hindu because father is a Hindu. Many Muslims are Muslims because father is a Muslim. This atheist, he's thinking. He may be coming from a family which does believe in the existence of God or may not believe. He does not agree that God exists. He's thinking. He's not blindly following. But one may ask me, but even if he's not blindly following, why are you congratulating him? The reason I congratulate an atheist is because he has said the first part of the Islamic Shahada, first part of the Islamic creed, La ilaha, there is no God. To the other non-Muslim, first I have to prove to him the God he's worshipping is wrong, is false. Here, half my job is done. He already agrees with the first part of the Shahada, La ilaha. The only thing I have to do is illallah, which I shall do inshallah. And then afterwards, Muhammad Rasulullah, that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the messenger of Allah. So here half my job is done. To the other non-Muslims, maybe I'll have to spend half my time in convincing them that the God that they're worshipping is wrong, and then talk about the one true God. Here half my job is done. That's the reason I congratulate the atheist. The first question that I normally ask the atheist is, what is the definition of God? For anyone to say God does not exist, he has to know the definition of God. If he does not know the definition of God, he cannot say God does not exist. Some people may agree with me, most will not agree. Let me give you an example. If I say this is a pen, for you to say this is not a pen, you should know the definition of pen. You may or may not know what I'm carrying in my hand, but if you do not know the definition of pen, you cannot say this is not a pen. I'm aware some people will argue with me and say, Brother Zakir, we know what you're carrying is a book. So if we know what you're carrying is a book, we need not know what is the definition of pen, and yet we can say this is not a pen. But I disagree with you. For you to say this is not a pen, you should know the definition of pen. For example, if I say this is a kitab, you may know the definition of book, and you know this is a book, but if you don't know what is a kitab, you will say this is not a kitab, and you're wrong. Because kitab in Arabic and Hindi and Urdu means book. So that is the reason for you to say this is not a pen, you have to know the definition of pen. If you do not know the definition of pen, you cannot say this is not a pen. In the same fashion, for anyone to say God does not exist, he should know the definition of God. Now all these atheists and agnostics who do not believe or doubt the existence of Almighty God, they look around them that the gods their family members are worshipping, or the God their friends are worshipping, this God, he makes mistakes. This God, he forgets. This God, he requires to eat. This God, he gets tired. This God, he requires to sleep. The gods that the people worship, they have human qualities. So this atheist says, why should I worship such a God? And I, Zakir Naik, I'm a Muslim, Even I do not agree that God can make a mistake, God can forget, God can get tired, God requires to sleep, God requires to eat. God doesn't have human qualities. Even I reject such God. Therefore I say, La ilaha, there is no God. Now if the atheist rejects God because he has been provided the wrong definition of God, we Muslims have to agree with him. Even we do not believe in such a God. For example, if a non-Muslim comes and tells me, I do not believe in Islam, which is a religion, which is merciless. It is a religion that promotes terrorism. It is a religion that is against women rights. It's a religion that is illogical. It is a religion which is against science. I too do not believe in a religion which is merciless, which promotes terrorism, which is illogical, which is against women's rights, which is against science. But I, as a Muslim, I have to correct the non-Muslim that you have a misinformation about Islam. And I'll prove to him that Islam, in fact, is the religion of mercy. It is derived from the Arabic word salam, which means peace. It is against terrorism. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maidah chapter 5 verse number 32 that if anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, he has saved the whole nation. This verse of the Quran clearly states that killing any innocent human being is prohibited. So how can Islam be a religion of terrorism? Islam is a logical religion. It is for men of understanding. That is the reason the Quran says, "The afala yuminun," will you not then understand? Will you not then believe? Do they not understand? Islam is a religion which is equal rights to women. It's mentioned in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse number 124 that if any of you believers, be it a male or a female, if you have faith and if you do righteous deed, you shall enter paradise. Islam is a religion of logic. Islam is a religion of science. The moment we clarify the misconception from the mind of the non-Muslim, he will start appreciating Islam. In the same fashion, this atheist, he has a wrong definition of God. So what should we Muslims do? We should give him the correct concept of God. The best reply that any Muslim can give regarding the concept of Almighty God, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is quote to him Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4, which says, Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Say, He is Allah one and only. Allahu samad. Allah, the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid walam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. Walam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him. This is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, given in the glorious Quran. If any person says that so-and-so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in this four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. Number one is, Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Say, He is Allah one and only. Number two, Allahu samad. Allah, the absolute and eternal. Number three, Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is he begotten. And number four, Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. This Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Touchstone, you know, when you go to buy gold or sell gold and you want to know how pure is the gold. So the goldsmith, he takes the gold jewelry and he rubs it against a touchstone and compares the color and then tells you, this gold is 24 karat gold. Or you may say, it is 22 karat gold. or he may say it is 18 karat gold, or he may say it is not gold at all, because all that glitters is not gold. Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Theo means God, logi means study, theology means study of God. Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Any God, any human being worships, put him to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If the God you are worshipping passes the test of Surah Ikhlas, then you are worshipping a true God. If he fails the test of Surah Ikhlas, then he is a false God. And I've given a talk on concept of God in Islam and concept of God in major world religions, which if any unbiased man who believes in a religion hears this talk, he will agree with the correct concept of God. But today in the world, we have many atheists for whom their main yardstick is science. They believe in science and technology. And many atheists come and ask me that, can you prove to me scientifically the existence of God? And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, Kul ya ahlul kitab, say, O people of the book, Ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa'in bainana wa bainakum, come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah, na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. Wala nushrika bihi shay'an, that we associate no partners with him. Wala yattakhiz ba'dun ba'dan arbaban min dunillah, that we erect not among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. Fa in tawallaw, then if they turn back. Fa qulu shahadu, say, I bear witness. Bi anna muslimun, that we are Muslims bowing our will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse of the glorious Quran shows as a way how to speak with different types of non-Muslim. And this verse says, Ta'ala ila kalimatin sawa'in bayna baynakum, come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illallah, that we worship none but Allah. So when I'm speaking to an atheist, people ask me, what is the common term? The common term is La ilaha. There is no God, therefore I congratulate him. Now, for the atheist, as I told you today, his yardstick is science. So let us try and prove to the atheist through his yardstick, science, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, existence of Almighty God. And while doing this, I will take the help of the last and final revelation of the glorious, the last and final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the glorious Quran. This glorious Quran is the last and final revelation of Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this lecture of mine, while I will prove, alhamdulillah, the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, with the help of the Quran, I will simultaneously also prove that this Quran, alhamdulillah, is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God. When I meet an atheist and is unable to define God, or his definition is wrong, I ask him a question. That if an equipment is bought in front of you, who no one in the world has seen before, who no one in the world knows about it, and if it's bought in front of you, and if the question is asked, who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this equipment? I would like to repeat the question so that you understand better. That if an atheist is asked the question and an equipment is bought in front of him who no one in the world has seen before, no one knows about it before, and if the question is asked, who will be the first person who will be able to tell you the mechanism of this equipment? What will be his answer? What will be his answer? Some may say the Creator. some may say the manufacturer, some may say the producer, some may say the inventor. Whatever he says, it will be somewhat similar. Don't grapple with the words. He'll either say the creator will be the first person who knows the mechanism, the inventor, the producer, or he may say the manufacturer. Just keep this at the back of your mind. Then I'll ask him the question that how did our universe come into existence? And he will tell me that our universe was initially a primary nebula. Then there was a secondary separation, a Big Bang, which gave rise to galaxies, to stars, to sun, to planets, and the earth on which we live. I ask him the question, when did you come to know about this? He will tell me, approximately 45 years back, in 1970s, when a couple of scientists got Nobel Prize for describing the creation of the universe. They called it the Big Bang. So I will tell him, what you're telling me about the Big Bang, about how the world came into existence, the earth came into existence, is already mentioned in my book, the Quran, 1400 years ago. It is mentioned in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30. It says, Awalam yara allazeena kafaru anna samawati wal arda kanat ratkan faftaknahuma. Do not the unbelievers see that the heavens and the earth were joined together and we clove them asunder? What you're talking about, what you came to know 45, 50 years back, is already mentioned in my Quran 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned in the Quran? So the atheist may say, maybe it's a fluke. Don't argue. Ask him the next question. What is the shape of the earth? The atheist will tell me that previously we thought that the earth was flat. It was in 1577 when Sir Francis Drake sailed around the earth that he proved the earth was spherical. So the atheist tells me, we came to know that the earth is spherical hardly 450 years back. I will tell him that what you came to know 450 years back, that the earth is spherical, is already mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. It's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 29. Alam tara anna allaha yulijul layla fil nahari yulijul nahara fil layli. It is Allah, it is He who merges the night into the day and merges the day into the night. Merging of the night into the day and day into the night can only take place if the earth is spherical. If it was flat, there would have been a sudden change. It's further mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 5, that it is He who overlaps the night unto the day and overlaps the day unto the night. The Arabic word is kawara, means to overlap or coil, how you coil a turban on the head. Now the coiling of the night unto the day and day unto the night is only possible if the earth was spherical. It's not possible if it was flat. Furthermore, it's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 30. Wal ard ba'da zalika dahaha. And thereafter, we have made the earth egg-shaped. And today we know that the earth is not completely round like a ball. It is flattened from the pole. It is geospherical in shape. And the Arabic word dahaha, one of its meaning is an expanse, and the earth is an expanse. The other meaning is derived from the Arabic word duya, which means an egg. And it doesn't refer to a normal egg, it specifically refers to the egg of an ostrich. And dahaha also refers to a place where the ostrich lays the egg. And if you analyze the shape of the egg of an ostrich, that too is geospherical in shape. It is flattened from the poles. Imagine, the Quran mentions 1400 years ago that the shape of the earth is geospherical, like the egg of an ostrich. I will ask the atheist, what you came to know 450 years back? My Quran says 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned that in the Quran? So he may say, your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, maybe he's a very intelligent man. Don't argue with him. Ask him the next question. The light of the moon, is it its own light or reflected light? So the atheist will tell you, previously we thought that the light of the moon was its own light. But after science's advance, we have come to know that the light of the moon is not its own light, it's a reflected light. I will tell you. Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 61, that blessed is he who has placed the constellation in the sky and placed therein sun having its own light and moon having reflected or borrowed light. The Arabic word used in the Quran for sun is shams. Its light is always described in the Quran as diya, siraj, or wahaj, meaning torch, blazing glory, or a shining glory. And the moon is called as kamar in the Quran. Its light is always described as munir or noor, meaning borrowed light or reflected light. And this message that the light of the moon is reflected and borrowed is also repeated in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 5, as well as Surah Nuh, chapter number 71, verse number 15, that the light of the moon is borrowed or reflected. I'll ask the atheist, who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago, that the light of the moon is not its own light, but it is a reflected or borrowed light? The atheist may say, maybe your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he was very intelligent, he was very well versed in science. Don't argue with him. Continue. When I was in school, I passed my school in 1982. I had learnt in school that the sun, along with the solar system, it did revolve, but the sun did not rotate about its own axis. The atheist says, is that what is mentioned in the Quran? I say, no, this is what I learnt in school. This is what I learnt in school about 34 years back. I learnt in school 34 years back that the sun did not rotate about its axis. But the Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 33, it says, "Huwa allazi khalaqal layla wan nahara." It is Allah who has created the night and the day. "Wa shamsa wal qamar," the sun and the moon. "Kullun fi falaki yasbahun," each one traveling in orbit with its own motion. The Arabic word yasbahun describes the motion of a moving body. If I use this word, the yasbahun is derived from the Arabic word sabaha, which describes the motion of a moving body. And if I use this word for a person on the floor, it will not mean he's rolling, it will mean he's walking or running. If I use it for a person in the water, it will not mean he's floating, it will mean he's swimming. Similarly, when it's mentioned in the Quran for a celestial body, it does not mean it is flying, it means it is rotating about its own axis. Imagine, I read in school about 34 years back that the sun was stationary, it did not rotate about its own axis, and the Quran says 1400 years ago that the sun rotates. But now, after science's advance, they have come to know that the sun does rotate. You can have the image of the sun on a tabletop, and we find there are black spots. And these black spots take about 25 days to complete one rotation, indicating that the sun takes about 25 days to complete one rotation. Imagine what I read in school. Today, after science's advance, we have come to know it is wrong. That means hardly 30, 40, 50 years back, we came to know that the sun also rotates about its own axis. And Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? Now the atheist, he will pause. He will not reply. Don't wait for the answer. Ask him the next question. You ask him the next question. That today the scientists, they tell us, the sunlight that we have is due to a chemical reaction that is taking place since billions of years. And one day, this chemical reaction will cease to exist, and life on the face of this earth will also cease to exist. Quran says in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 34. It says, وَشَمْسَ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ. Surah Yasin, chapter 36, verse number 38. وَشَمْسَ تَجْرِي لِمُسْتَقَرِ اللَّهَ. The sun is running its course for a period determined. Mustaqar, besides meaning a period determined, also means a place determined. That means the Quran says, the sun will only function for a period determined. The other meaning, a place determined, today's science tells us, that the sun, along with the solar system, is moving to a point in the universe, in the Herculeans, which is known as Alpha Lyra, as the solar apex, at a speed of 12 miles per second. What science came to know today, that the sun is moving to a point determined and will be there for a period determined, is mentioned in the Quran 1400 years ago. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? And the atheists will be silent. Don't wait for the answer. Ask him the next question. That today science tells us the atmosphere that we have outside the earth, it prevents, it acts like a ceiling. It prevents the harmful radiation, the X-rays and the ultraviolet rays from entering the earth, the surface of the earth. If this was not there, then life would not exist on the face of the earth. Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 32, that we have made the sky as a protected ceiling. What science discovered recently, 50 years back, 100 years back, 200 years back, 300 years back, the Quran mentions 1400 years ago that the sky has been made a protected ceiling. When I was in school, I had learned that there are three states of matter: solid, liquid, and gas. And the scientists that time, they thought that outside the organized astronomical system, there was vacuum. Today the scientists say that outside the organized astronomical system are bridges of matter which they call as plasma. And this, they say, is the fourth state of matter. Quran says in Surah Shura, chapter number 42, verse number 11, it is Almighty God who has created the heaven and the earth and everything in between. Also says Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 59, that Allah has created the heaven and the earth and everything in between. That means there are things in between the organized astronomical system, which today the scientists call as plasma, the fourth state of matter. According to Edwin Hubble, who was a very famous scientist, he discovered in the last century that our universe is expanding, and it was one of the greatest discoveries of the last century. Our universe is receding from one another, and Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. It's mentioned in Surah Dhariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 47, that we have created the vastness of space, the expanding universe. The Arabic word is Mu'siuna, vastness. Imagine what the scientists came to know recently, hardly 100 years back. The Quran mentions 1400 years ago that the universe is expanding. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? And the atheists would be silent. There may be certain skeptics who will say, it's nothing great that the Quran speaks about astronomy. Since the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy, I do agree with them that the Arabs were advanced in the field of astronomy, but I would like to remind them, it was centuries after the Quran was revealed that the Arabs became advanced in the field of astronomy. So it's from the Quran that the Arabs learned about astronomy and not the vice versa. in the field of physics about 23 centuries ago, there was a very famous theory known as theory of atomism. It was propounded by the Greeks, by the Democrats, and they believed that atom is the smallest part of matter which cannot be divided. And this was also known to the Arabs. This was also known to the Arabs, and in Arabic it was called a zarra. Zarra, meaning an atom, the smallest part according to scientists. But today science has advanced and we have come to know that the atom, though, is the smallest part of matter. Having the characteristic of an element, it too can be divided into neutrons, into protons. And the Quran speaks about zarra. So many people may think if the Quran speaks about zarra as the smallest part, and today science tells us that the atom can be divided, that means the Quran is outdated. If you read the Quran says in Surah Saba, chapter number 34, verse number 3, that when they tell you that the hour will never come, the hour of judgment, tell them it will surely come with the permission of thy Lord, in whose record is mentioned the smallest detail of an atom, talking about the zarra, and even things smaller and greater than the atom. That means Quran already mentions that there are things smaller and greater than the atom. And this message is repeated in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 61, that when they ask thee regarding the hour, tell them the hour will surely come with the permission of their Lord, in whose record is very clear, is propitious, things as small as the atom and things greater and smaller than the atom. So the Quran is not outdated, it is up to date. It tells in advance that there are things smaller and greater than the atom. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran? In the field of hydrology, in school we learn about the water cycle. And the water cycle we learn in the school was first propounded by Sir Bernard Palissy in 1580. And we learn in school that the water evaporates from the ocean, it rises, forms into clouds, the clouds move in the interior, they fall down as rain, and the water table is replenished. We learn this in school. Previously, in 2nd century BC, Thales of Miletus, he said it was the spray of the ocean which was picked up by the wind which fell into the interior like rain. Previously, people thought it was the pressure of the wind on the ocean which thrust the water into the interior. We did not know how did the underground water come. So first people thought it was the pressure of the wind which forced the water into the interior, and it went back by a secret passage known as Tartarus at the time of Plato. Even till as late as 17th century, Descartes believed in this. Even in 19th century, Aristotle, he propounded the theory that the underground water was due to the mountain caverns, they feeding the underground water. Today we know that the underground water is due to the seepage of the rainwater in the cracks in the ground. It's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 21. Seest not thou, it is he who sends down water from the sky and leads it in cracks and grounds and causes sown field of varying colors to grow. Quran is talking about the underground water 14 years ago, which we came to know recently. Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail. The Quran says in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 24, it is he who sends out water from the sky and gives life to the earth after it is dead. It's mentioned in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 18. It is He who sends on water from the sky, and He is able to store it or even drain it. It's mentioned in Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 22. It says that it is He who sends fecundating winds, winds impregnating. The Arabic word lawaki, coming from the word lakaha, means to impregnate. And today we know that science tells us that the pollen is picked up by the wind, impregnates the cloud and waterfalls. And one more reason is that when the clouds join together and later on the water falls from the sky. It's further mentioned in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 43, that the clouds rise, they join together, and then water emerges from the top, from the sky. It's mentioned in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 48, that the water rises from the sky, forms into clouds, the cloud moves the interior, they join together, they make a heap, and the water emerges from the sky. The Quran speaks about the water cycle in great detail in several verses. In Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 57. In Surah Rod, chapter number 13, verse number 17. In Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 48 and 49. In Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 9. In Surah Ghashiya, chapter number 45, verse number 5. In Surah Qaf, chapter number 50, verse number 9 and 10. It's mentioned in Surah Waqia, chapter 56, verse number 67 to 70. It's mentioned in Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 30. It's mentioned in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 11. There are verses I can keep on quoting only in the Quran which talk about water cycle. Who could have mentioned so much detail about the water cycle which we came to know in the 16th century, some of it, and some of it recently? Don't wait for the answer, you can continue. Today in the field of geology, the geologists tell us that the earth on which we live, it's approximately little less than 4,000 miles in radius. And the deeper layer, they are hot and fluid and cannot sustain life. But the layers on top, it gets solid, and the superficial layer is a thin crust, hardly 1 to 10 miles in thickness. It's less than 1% in thickness. And there are high possibility that this superficial crust of the earth, it will shake. It is due to the folding phenomena which gives rise to mountain ranges which gives the stability to the earth. So today the scientists say it is due to the mountain ranges that the earth is stable. The Quran says in Surah Nabah, chapter number 78, verse number 6 and 7, we have made the earth as an expanse, wal jibal autada, and the mountains as stakes. The Arabic word autad means stakes, means tent pegs. When you put a tent peg into the ground, the major peg goes deep in the ground, you see only a small portion above the ground. So similarly, the mountain that you see, the portion above the ground is a very small percentage. The major percentage is deep underground. Like how you see an iceberg. The iceberg that you see on top of the water is very small, less than 10%. The major portion of the iceberg is below water. Similarly, the mountains on top of the earth is a very small portion. The major portion is deep within the ground. The Quran says in Surah Naziat, chapter number 79, verse number 32, and Surah Ghashiya, chapter number 88, verse number 19, that we have placed mountains standing firm. And when you read the book The Earth, which is one of the most referred book in the universities in the subject of geology, one of its authors, his name is Dr. Frank Press, and he writes in this book The Earth, and he draws the mountain, and he shows that the mountain has got deep roots, and the roots are wedge shaped, deep roots. And the portion you see above is a very small percentage. The major portion is deep underground. And Dr. Frank Press, who was an authority in geology, was also the president of the Academic Science in USA and was also the scientific advisor to the previous president of USA, Jimmy Carter. He says that the function of the mountain is to prevent the earth from shaking, which he told just 50 years back, 100 years back. And Quran mentioned 1400 years ago in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 31, as well as Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 5, and Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 10. Quran says, we have placed on the earth mountain standing firm, lest it would shake with you. So Quran describes the function of the mountain to prevent the earth from shaking, which we discovered recently. Who would have mentioned this in the Quran? In the field of oceanology, there's a verse in the Quran which is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 53, which says, we have let free two bodies of flowing water, one sweet and palatable, the other is salty and bitter. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier, there is a barzakh, which is forbidden to be trespassed. The message is repeated in Surah Rahman, chapter number 55, verse number 19 and 20, which says, Marajal bairani yaltaqiyan bainama barzakhul la yabghiyan. It is he who has let free two bodies of water, flowing water. Though they meet, they do not mix. There is a barrier which is forbidden to be trespass. Previously, the commentators of the Quran, they knew that there are two types of water, salty and sweet, but they could not understand what does the Quran mean by saying that these two waters meet, but they do not mix. There is a barrier, there is a barzakh between them. Today, after science advance, we have come to know that whenever one type of water flows into the other type of water, whenever sweet water flows into the salty water, it loses its constituents and gets homogenized into the water it flows. This area, homogenizing area, the Quran refers to as barzakh. Whenever one type of water flows into the other type of water, it loses its constituents and gets homogenized into the water it flows. This homogenizing area, the Quran refers to as barzakh. And this can be seen in several places in the world. If you go to Cape Town, that the southern part of South Africa, you can see these two waters meeting. You can even see the color between these two waters different. In Egypt, when River Nile flows into the Mediterranean Sea, and the best example is the Gulf of Mexico, which starts from the Gulf of Mexico. It flows for thousands of miles from the Gulf of Mexico. It goes northwards towards the east coast of North America, then flows eastwards and goes towards the west coast of Europe. Though it flows for thousands of miles, both waters are distinct. And if you travel in a boat in the Gulf Stream and pick up water from the left side and pick up water from the right side, one is sweet and the other is salty. Even the temperature between the two, it differs. Further, when you read in the subject of oceanology, there was a verse in the Quran, Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 40, which was shown to Prophet Dr. Durga Rao, who is a marine engineer and expert in the field of oceanology. He was teaching in the King Abdullah University in Jeddah. Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 40 says, as to the state of the unbeliever, it is like the depth of darkness. It's like the depths of darkness in a vast deep ocean. Waves topped with waves, topped with dark clouds. If a man stretches out his hand, he cannot see. For to whom Allah sends no light, he does not see. What does this verse of the Quran mean by saying the state of an unbeliever's mind is like the depth of darkness in a vast deep sea, vast deep ocean? Waves topped with waves, topped with dark clouds. Darkness above darkness. If a man touches out his hand, he cannot see. For to whom Allah gives no light, he will not see. When Professor Durga Rao was shown this verse, he said that this verse is not referring to a normal sea. It is referring to a vast, deep ocean. And previously we did not know that the depth of the ocean was dark, because a human being cannot go more than 20 to 30 meters unaided. It is in 1900 when we discovered submarines, we came to know that the deep part of the ocean, it is dark. Even the fishes which swim in the deep part of the ocean, they have their own light. And Professor Durga Rao said that this darkness is due to two phenomena. Number one, when the light enters the ocean, the light is absorbed in layers. And today we know that the light has got seven components, and we learnt in school about VIPure: violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange and red. It has seven components. So when light enters the ocean, the first 10 to 15 meters of the water, it absorbs the red color. So if a man swimming below 25 meters, if he gets injured and if blood comes out, he will not be able to see the red color of his blood. And I remember when I had gone to Mauritius, I had the opportunity of going in a submarine down. So what I did, I took a Kit Kat paper, you know, which is red in color, Kit Kat chocolate. And as the moment we kept on going down, when we went below about 15, 20 meters, the red color disappeared. It was like a dark brown something, but I could not see red. When I took out my mobile and on the light, I could see the red color again, because the light was there. The moment I switched off the mobile, the torch in my mobile, it was again dark. It wasn't red. So I could personally see, because the red color is absorbed by the first 10 to 15 meters. From 30 to 50 meters, the orange color is absorbed. From 50 to 100 meters, the yellow color is absorbed. From 100 to 200 meters, the green color is absorbed. And below 200 meters, the blue color is absorbed, and violet and indigo also. So the light is absorbed in layers, part by part. That's the reason you see darkness in layers. As the Quran says, darkness on darkness. The second reason why there's darkness is, when the sunlight, before it reaches the earth, many a times it is obstructed by the cloud, and the cloud absorbs it, and you see a dark patch below the cloud. This is one of the reasons that light is absorbed. And that which is not obstructed by the cloud, it reaches the ocean, and many a time that is reflected by the waves, you see the silvery. But the Quran says waves topped with waves. What does the Quran mean by waves topped with waves? We see the waves on the superficial part of the ocean. It is recently, about more than 100 years back, 50 years back, 100 years back, 150 years back, we came to know that there are even internal waves. This internal waves, it separates the ocean into two parts, superficial ocean and the deep ocean. The superficial ocean is lit up and warm. The deep ocean is dark and cold. So the Quran says, the state of an unbeliever's mind is like the depths of darkness. Waves topped with waves, topped with dark clouds. Darkness above darkness. If a man stretches out his hand, he cannot see it. For to whom Allah gives no light, light will not reach him. In the field of biology, the Quran says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 30, it says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ هَيْ أَفْلَا إِمِنُونَ. We have created every living thing from water. Will you not then believe? Imagine in the deserts of Arabia, where there was scarcity of water, who would have believed that every living creature is made of water? You could have thought of something else like sand, etc. But water? Quran mentioned this 1400 years ago. And today we have come to know that every living creature has a cell which contains cytoplasm, which contains 80% water. And every living organism, every living creature contains 50 to 90% water. Imagine, Quran mentions this 1400 years ago. The Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 45, we have created every animal from water. Quran says in Surah Furqan, chapter number 25, verse number 54, we have created the human beings from water. In the field of botany, previously we did not know that even the plants have sexes, male and female. We came to know recently. Quran says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20, verse number 53, it is he who sends down water from the sky and with it brings diverse pairs of plants, each separate from the other. The Arabic word is azwaj, meaning pairs. That means pulses, each separate from the other. So Quran says that even the plants have got sexes, male and female. Quran says in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 3, that we have created every kind of fruit in pairs, twos and twos. The Quran says in Surah Yasin, chapter number 36, verse number 36, we have created everything in pairs, the things you know and the things you don't know. Today, we have come to know even things like electricity. They are created in pairs, positive and negative. Even the atoms, like protons and neutrons, negative and positive. So Quran says in Surah Yasin, chapter 36, verse number 36, we have created everything in pairs, things you know and things you don't know. Who could have mentioned this in the Quran 1400 years ago? In the field of mathematics, there is something called as theory of probability. That means if you make a wild guess, what are the chances that you will be correct? This is called as theory of probability. For example, and it says that the number of options you have, and if one of them is correct, you divide one by the number of options, you get the probability. For example, if you toss a coin, it can either be heads or tails. If you make a wild guess, whether you say head or whether you say tails, the chances you'll be right is 1/2. It is 50%. If you toss a coin twice, the chances you'll be correct both the times is 1/2 × 1/2 is 50% of 50%, it is 1/4, it is 25%. If you toss a coin thrice, the chances you'll be correct all three times is 1/2 × 1/2 × 1/2 is 1/8. It is 50% of 50% of 50%, it is 12.5%. If you throw a dice, there are six options. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The chances that if you make a wild guess, you'll be correct is 1/6. If you throw a dice twice, and the chances you'll be correct both the times is 1/6 × 1/6 is 1/36. If you throw a dice thrice, and the chances you'll be correct all three times is 1/6 × 1/6 × 1/6 is 1/216. This is called as theory of probability. So if someone says that someone wrote the Quran and by chance, fluke, he got it right. Let's analyze the theory of probability. For example, if you ask, what is the shape of the earth? Maybe you can give 10 shapes. You can say it is square, it is triangle, it is hexagonal, it's heptagonal, it is flat, it is spherical. You can give 10 options. The chances if you make a wild guess and you're correct is 1 upon 10. The light of the moon, is it its own light or reflected light? There are two options. The chances if you make a wild guess you will be correct is 1 upon 2, it is 50%. The chances that you're right both the times, the shape of the earth is spherical and the light of the moon is reflected light, is 1 upon 10 by 1 upon 2 is 1 upon 20, it is 5%. Chances will be correct. The living creature, the Quran says, we have created every living thing from water. If you want to guess what are the living creatures made of, you can guess 10,000 things. Wood, iron, aluminium, steel, wool, water, 10,000 things. The chances if you make a wild guess and it will be correct is 1 upon 10,000. The chances that all three if you make a wild guess, the earth is spherical, the light of the moon is reflected, and everything is made from water. The chances you'll be correct if you make a wild guess is 1 upon 10 into 1 upon 2 into 1 upon 10,000, 1 upon 60,000. 1 upon 60,000 is equal to 0.00017%. Only with these three, you get 0.00017%. And there are more than 1,000 verses of the Quran which speak about science. And not a single is against scientific fact. The probability will be 0.0000, how many zeros I don't know. And today science tells us, if 10 raised to 50, 10 raised to 50 means 50 zeros, it is zero. So mathematically, it is improbable. It's not possible. It's impossible that someone makes a wild guess and all of it is correct. The Quran mentions about several other scientific facts. Time will not permit me to say everything, I'll just mention a few more. In the field of zoology, Quran says in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 38, every animal that walks on the earth and every bird that flies in the air lives in community like the human beings. And today science tells us that the animals and the birds, they live in community like the human beings. Quran says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 and 69, that he has taught the bee to build its cells in hills, in trees, and in human habitations, and to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill. What does the Quran mean by saying that the bee has been taught to find the spacious path of thy Lord with great skill? It was Sir Fawn Fresh in 1973 who got the Nobel Prize for describing the behavior of the bee, and he said that whenever a bee finds a new flower or a new garden, it goes and tells its fellow bee the exact direction of the new flower or the new garden by a process known as the bee dance. Imagine, Quran mentions about this 1400 years ago, which we came to know recently, hardly 45, 50 years back. Furthermore, Quran says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter 16, verse number 16 and 69, the worker bee is called as Fasruki, meaning a female bee. Previously, we thought it was the male bee which was the worker bee. That's the reason Shakespeare, in his play, Henry IV, he says that the male bees are the soldier bee, and they report to the king. Today we have come to know that the worker bee are the female bee and not the male bee, and they don't report to the king, they report to the queen. Imagine, Quran even mentions the sex of the worker bee as being female 1400 years ago. It's mentioned in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 41, that as to those who take for protectors anyone besides the Creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they build for themselves houses like that of the spider. For verily, the house of the spider is fragile. Besides Quran saying, if you take for protector anyone besides your Lord, you build for yourself house which is fragile, like the web of a spider. Today we have come to know that many a times the female spider kills the male spider, kills the husband, and is called as the black widow. So besides describing the fragility of the home of the spider, it even talks about the family relationship, which is very bad. Quran says in Surah Naml, chapter number 27, verse number 17 and 18, that when Solomon and his army with host of men, jinns and birds, when they approached a lowly valley of ants, one of the ants said, "O ye ants, get into your habitations, lest Solomon and his army will trample you beneath their feet." People may think, what kind of a fairy tale book is the Quran? The ant talking among themselves. Today we have come to know the enemy or insect which has the closest resemblance to that of the human being, it is the ants. The ant bury the dead the same way as the human beings do. They have a sophisticated method of labor where they have a manager, a foreman, a worker. They have a very sophisticated method of communication. They very often meet to chat. They even have marketplaces where they exchange goods. You know, we have souk marketplaces. They have marketplaces where they exchange goods. And the ant, if it stored a grain, and if the grain began to bud, it chops off the bud as though it knew that budding will cause rotting of the grain. And if the grain got wet, it got it out in the sunlight to dry as though it knew that humidity will cause the rotting of the grain. You know, sometimes we see the ant carrying the grain in the sunlight, then as a kid has to wonder, where is the ant taking the grain? Science tells us when the grain gets wet, it gets it out in the sunlight to dry as though it knew that humidity will cause the rotting of the grain. In the field of physiology, there's a verse in the Quran which talks about the production of milk and the blood circulation. Blood circulation was first discovered by Ibn Nafis about 600 years after the Quran was revealed. And 400 years after Ibn Nafis, William Harvey made it famous to the Western world. Today in our school books, we learn about William Harvey, but we don't know about Ibn Nafis. It was Ibn Nafis who first discovered the blood circulation. William Harvey, 400 years later, 1000 years after the Quran was revealed, he made it famous to the Western world. Quran, 1000 years before William Harvey, and 600 years before Ibn Nafis, says about the blood circulation and the production of milk in a nutshell. Today science tells us that the food we eat, it goes into the stomach. From the stomach, via the bloodstream, it enters almost all the different organs of the body. Many a times goes via the liver, a very complex method. It even enters the mammary gland, which is responsible for the production of milk. This thing is mentioned in a nutshell in the Quran 1400 years ago in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 16, where the Quran says, "Verily in the cattle is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body." Coming from a conjunction between the constituents of the intestine and blood, milk which is pure for you to have. The same message is repeated in Surah Mu'minun, chapter number 23, verse number 21. "Verily in the cattle is an example for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body." Coming from a conjunction of the constituents of the intestine, milk which is pure for you to have, and of the meat you can eat. Imagine, Quran speaks about the blood circulation and production of milk in a nutshell 1400 years ago. In the field of medicine, the Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 68 and 69, that from the belly of the bee you get a drink of varying colors in which there is healing for humankind. Previously we did not know that the honey was obtained from the belly of the bee, we came to know recently, about 200, 300 years back. Quran mentions 1400 years ago that from the belly of the bee, we give you a drink of varying colors in which there is healing for mankind. Today, science tells us that the honey has got mild antiseptic properties. No wonder the Russian soldiers in World War II used honey to cover up the wound. There was very little scar tissue left and healing was done. And due to the density of the honey, germs and bacteria was prevented to grow in the wound. And if a person is suffering from allergy of a particular plant, if honey from that particular plant is given to that patient, he starts developing resistance to that allergy. In the field of medicine, in the field of embryology, embryology is the study of the development of the embryo, the development of the child in the womb of the mother. In medical terminology, it's called as embryology, study of the embryo, study of the development of the human being. In the field of embryology, there were a group of Arabs who collected the verses in the Quran and the Hadith talking about embryology and took it to Professor Keith Moore, who was an authority in that field, following the verse of the Quran of Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 7, which says, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum la ta'lamun. If you don't know, ask the person who is knowledgeable. So they took the verses of the Quran and presented to Keith Moore those verses which deal with embryology and the Hadith. And when Professor Keith Moore read these verses, he said that more than, he said that almost all the verses in the Quran which talk about embryology are 100% in conformity with what modern embryology says. But there are a couple of verses which I cannot say that they are right. Neither can I say they are wrong, because I myself don't know. And two such verses were the first two verses of the Quran to be revealed, which says, Ikra bismi rabbikal ladhi khalaq. Khalaqal insana min alaq. Read, recite, and proclaim in the name of thy Lord who created. Who created the human beings from something which clings, a leech-like substance. So Professor Keith Moore said, I do not know whether an embryo looks like a leech or not. So he went into his laboratory and under a very powerful microscope, he observed the early stages of an embryo and compared it with a photograph of a leech. And he was astonished at the striking resemblance. And later on he said, when about 80 questions were asked to him, he said, if you would have asked me this question, this was in the early 1980s and late 1970s, that if you would have asked me these questions 30 years before, I would not be able to answer more than 50%, because embryology is a new development. Embryology is a new development in the medical science. And it was hardly, it came about 70, 80 years back. This question was asked to Keith Moore in 1970s late, 1980s early, and 30 years before that, the development of embryology started from 1950, about 65 years back. He said, if you had asked me this question more than 30 years back, I would not be able to answer more than 50%. And furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Tariq, chapter number 86, verse number 5-7, that does not man think from what is created? He is created from a drop emitted between the backbone and the ribs. What does the Quran mean by saying human beings have been created from a drop emitted from the back, between the backbone and the ribs? And today science tells us that the genital organs in the human beings, in the male the testes, in the female the ovaries, they originate initially in a space where the kidney is present, between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. Later on, they descend during the embryonic life. And then in the male, they descend via the inguinal canal into the scrotum, the ovaries, and that is the testes. And in the female, the ovaries descend to the true pelvis. But even in the adult life, after the genital organ descent, they yet receive the blood supply from the same space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib, and the venous return goes back to the same space between the backbone and the 11th and 12th rib. Even the nerve supply comes from the same space. Furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Mu'minun chapter number 23 verse number 13 and Surah Hajj chapter number 22 verse number 5, we have created the human beings from a nutfa, from a minute quantity of liquid. Minute means a very small quantity. Today science tells us that in a normal emission, about 300 million sperms are emitted. Only one sperm is sufficient for the fertilization of the ovum, nutfa. The Quran further says in Surah Sajda, chapter number 32, verse number 8, we have created the human beings from salala, the best part of the whole. The one sperm out of 300 million sperm, the Quran refers to as salala, the best part of the whole. Furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Insan, chapter number 76, verse number 2, we have created the human beings from nutfatin amshaj, a minute quantity of mingled fluid. And we know, besides the ovum and the sperm, there are spermatic fluids and other fluids which are responsible for the production of the human beings. In the field of genetics, today science tells us that the sex of the child is determined by the 23rd pair of chromosomes. If it's XX, it's a female. If it's XY, it's a male. And it is the male sperm which is responsible for deciphering the sex of the child. If the X of the male takes part in the fertilization, a female is born. If the Y of the male takes part in fertilization, then a male is born. Quran says in Surah Najm, chapter number 53, verse number 45, we have created the human beings from a minute quantity of fluid gushing forth from a male, and then gave it sex, male and female. The Quran says clearly in Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 37 to 39, we have created the human beings from a nutfa, minute quantity of liquid, then made it into a mudga. Then we gave from a minute quantity of sperm. The Arabic word used is, we have made the human being from a minute quantity of sperm, nutfatin min mani yumna, and then gave it sex, male and female. So Quran says, it is the sperm, it is the male fluid which is responsible for deciphering the sex of the child, which I have come to know recently. The country where I come from, India, they prefer having sons instead of daughters, for reason is known best to them. And if a daughter-in-law gives birth to a daughter, very often the mother-in-law will blame the daughter-in-law. Why did you give birth to a daughter? You should have given birth to a son. Whether it's a son or a daughter, male or a female, it's in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But today science, as well as the Quran says, it is the male which is responsible for deciphering the sex of the child and not the female. So if the mother-in-law has to blame someone, she should blame the son, she should not blame the daughter-in-law. Furthermore, the Quran says in Surah Zumar, chapter number 39, verse number 6, that we have created the human beings in stages in womb of the mother, one after the other, in three veils of darkness. Prophet Keith Moore said, these three veils of darkness refers to the anterior abdominal wall, it refers to the amniocoronic membrane and the uterine wall. And the Quran says in Surah Insan, chapter number 76, verse number 2, we have given the human being the faculty of hearing and sight. Today science tells us the first sense to develop is the sense of hearing. By the 5.5 month of pregnancy, the ear splits open. And later on, the eye splits open at 7th month. So first sense to develop is the sense of hearing, then the sense of sight. There was an experiment done many years back at the days where there were manual typewriters. There was a child, a newborn child taken, who was a newborn child whose mother was a typist using a manual typewriter, and other 9 children were taken for normal mothers, and all the 10 newborns were placed together and the typewriter was sounding. All of them got scared except the child whose mother was a typist, because he was used to hearing the sound of the typewriter in the womb of the mother. That is the reason it's mentioned in the hadith that when a woman is pregnant, she should recite the Quran. It's helpful for the newborn child. And today science tells us that the pregnant woman should not see horror movies, etc. She should be careful. It will affect the child. The first comes the sense of hearing, then the sight. Due to limitation of time, I'll just mention 2 more scientific facts before I end the lecture. It is mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Qiyamah, chapter number 75, verse number 3-4, that when they ask, how will Almighty God be able to reconstruct our bones after we have been buried, the bones have got disintegrated, how will He be able to reconstruct our bones on the Day of Judgment? So the Quran replies, tell them, He will not only be able to reconstruct the bones, He can reconstruct in very perfect order the very tips of the finger. What does the Quran mean by saying He can not only reconstruct the bone, but reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of the finger? It was in 1880 that Sir Francis Gold discovered the fingerprinting method and said that no 2 fingerprints, even in 1,000,000 people, are identical. Today the CIA, the CID, the FBI, they use the fingerprinting method in identifying the culprit. Imagine, Quran mentioned 1400 years ago that Almighty God can not only reconstruct the bones, He can even reconstruct in perfect order the very tips of the finger. I would like to mention the last scientific fact. So Prophet Thakrathakashon, who hailed from Thailand, he did a great deal of research on pain. He did research on pain receptors. And today the doctors, they tell us, previously we thought only the brain was responsible for feeling of pain. After science advanced, we have come to know there are certain receptors in the skins which are also responsible for feeling of the pain, which today we call as pain receptors. That is the reason if a patient of burn injury comes, the doctor takes a pin and pricks it in the area of burn. If the patient feels pain, the doctor is happy. It's a superficial burn. The pain receptors are intact. If the patient does not feel pain, the doctor is sad. It's a deep burn. The pain receptors have been destroyed. When Prophet Thakrathakashon was approached, he was given the translation of verse of the Quran, of Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 56, he says, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them in the hellfire. And as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. The Quran says, as often as the skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Indicating there is something in the skin which is responsible for the feeling of pain. When Prophet Thakrathakashon was shown the verse of the Quran, he said, how could a book 1400 years ago talk about pain receptors which we discovered recently? Later on, checking with Prophet Keith Moore and other scientists, he was so impressed that in the 9th medical conference in Riyadh, he said the Shahada, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There is no God but Allah, and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Now coming back to the atheist. After every scientific fact, you ask him, who could have mentioned in the Quran? The only reply the atheist can give you is the answer he gave you the first time. The creator, the manufacturer, the inventor, the producer, the maker. This creator, this manufacturer, this inventor, this producer, this maker, we Muslims call as Allah. So this book, the glorious Quran, which came into existence 1400 years ago, could not have been revealed by anyone except the creator of the human beings, of the universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A very famous scientist, by the name of Albert Einstein, he said that science without religion is lame, and religion without science is blind. Let me remind you that the glorious Quran is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E, but it's a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. And there are more than 6,000 signs, 6,000 ayats in the glorious Quran, out of which more than 1,000 speak about signs. Many people may ask me, the Brother Zakir, you are using science to prove the Quran is the word of God? I say, no. I'm taking the yardstick of the non-Muslims, of the atheists, and comparing with my yardstick, the goal is Quran. Yardstick means something which is superior. For me, number one is the Quran, not science. I'm comparing their yardstick, the science, with my yardstick, the Quran, and proving my yardstick, the Quran, is far superior than your yardstick, science. I'm not using science to prove the Quran, right? I'm using their yardstick and comparing with my yardstick. And when you are comparing science with Quran, be careful. Only talk about scientific facts. Don't talk about scientific theories and hypotheses, because many a times these theories and hypotheses, they take U-turn. That's the reason Francis Bacon, a very famous philosopher, said that little knowledge of science makes you an atheist. In-depth knowledge of science makes you a believer in God. That's the reason today science is not eliminating God, it is eliminating models of God. La ilaha illallah. Science today is not eliminating God, it is eliminating models of God. This cannot be God, this cannot be God, this cannot be God, except Allah. La ilaha illallah. I would like to end my talk with the verse I started my talk with, of Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 53, where Allah says in the Quran, سَنُورِهِمْ آيَاتِينَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَا لَوْ أَنَّوْ لَقْ أَوَلَمْ يَخْفِ بِرَبِّكَ أَنَّوْ لَكُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. Soon we shall show them our signs in the furthest regions of the horizons and into the soul, until it is clear to them that this is the truth. وَآخْرِ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zakir Naik. Tuan-tuan dan puan-puan yang dirahmati Allah sekalian, kita berikan sekali lagi tepukan kepada Dr. Zakir Naik. As the time given is very limited, we may begin with the Q&A session. I believe that we have volunteers to assist Dr. Zakir Naik. How many microphone ports available? Can anybody assist me? Microphone port. We're supposed to have how many? We're supposed to have 4 microphone port. So I will provide few guidelines, and inshallah, Dr. Zakir Naik will add. Number one, I would like to invite the non-Muslims audience to come forward, and the non-Muslim will be given a priority to ask question to Dr. Zakir Naik. That's the first thing. Second, since we have 4 microphone ports, so the thing that we are going to do is that each question will be allowed for each microphone port. I repeat, each question will be allowed for each microphone port. And it will be conducted in the clockwise rotation. So I will hand over to you, Dr. Zaki.
Alhamdulillah, we come to the second part of the session, which is the question answer session, which is more interesting than the first part with the monologue. The second part is more of a dialogue.